So Eye of Zombie is the book. I don't say it's my favorite because it's like, okay, yeah, Captain America: Winter Soldier is my technically my favorite of the Marvel movies, but we all know I cried at Endgame. It was also great. So at the end of the day, we're having a good time. If it's sand, if it's Beacon 23, I'm having a good time. But when I talk to people, if they say I've never heard of Hugh Howey, I say read Wool. If they're already reading Wool, and I'm, you know, prior to quarantine, I was substitute teaching, and I would get a little thrill when I would see somebody carrying around either the Marvel graphic novel or a copy of Wool. Oh my God, I know him online. He's my internet friend, and I'm very excited that you're reading that. And I will always say, okay, well, if you like that, have you tried Eye Zombie? Because
you're just trying to turn them off with the rest of my books.
It's my favorite, but it might be my favorite.
Wow. I figure you're just trying to, like, turn them off of all of my other books.
Yeah, clear them out. Now read my stuff.
I was at a breakfast with, like, the head of one of the major publishers, and we're talking about publishing stuff, and I didn't think this person had read any of my stuff. They're just sitting beside me, and we're talking about publishing. And a break in the conversation, this guy leans over and he says, you know, I've read all your stuff. And I'm like, holy mackerel, that's a lot to read. And why are you reading my stuff? And then the next sentence was, Eye Zombie was my favorite. And I was like, what? And I was shocked that this person had read it, and kind of then embarrassed because I knew they had read, like, some of the grossest stuff I've ever written. But then they said, like, it's your most literary work. And I was like, what is happening? This is like, you know, it was the head of one of the major six publishers who was saying, like, Eye Zombie was a literary, my great literary work. And I was like, whatever. It just didn't make any sense.
I think about that book at least once a month. If it's a bad month, maybe three times. I'll be thinking, oh, what'd you do again? Can't you played games all night. It's me, Zombie. I did it again. And then I'll turn to my wife, and I'm like, did I ever tell you? She's like, yes, Eye Zombie by Hugh Howey. You told me about it. Oh, okay.
Yeah. But,
why do you think that of those of us that truly love it, because it's a punishing book, and it doesn't have a straightforward narrative, but it's endlessly captivating. What is it about that book you think that does so appeal to people?
I think even if we're not there's a lot of characters in the book. And even if we're not one of those characters, there's something about our own life that we see in that same trap. It's been one of the biggest revelations for me as a human, is realizing that I don't have free will. And that shakes you to your core. Like, losing religion was harder for me. Like, losing religion was probably second on the list. Losing Santa Claus was third. And apologies to any of your young viewers who might still believe in Santa Claus or Jesus. I apologize to all of them. But losing the belief in free will was absolutely number one on my great disillusions in life. And coping with that was difficult. And that book was really my ode to, like, how difficult that transition has been. And there's one character in that book that doesn't feel like they have any free will, but they feel if they try as hard as they can steer this body a little bit off of its predetermined path. You know, if they just feel like they're leaning into the skull of this creature they're inside of, and they're able to get it to get off the rails a bit. And that's how I feel a lot of times. Like, you know, all I want to do are, like, repeat certain mistakes or bad habits, and overcoming those requires an intense force of what feels like willpower, but it's just a slight deflection from your original path. And free will would mean that whatever we want to accomplish in life, it's just easy. If I want to sit down and write all day, I sit down and write, and I'm never distracted by the internet or anything else. If I want to, you know, exercise 1 hour every day, I decide that. And then next thing I know, 1 hour every day I'm exercising. And that's not reality, you know. Every New Year's, people make all these resolutions, and by February, most people have given up on them. And that's the reality of our lack of free will. And so Eye Zombie is a book about that. And what I've learned is, for myself, might not be true for anyone else, is as soon as I accepted that I didn't have free will, I got more control over myself and more understanding of my behavior than I ever had before, which took away so much of the frustration of watching yourself behave in a way that you're sometimes don't agree with and feel like you don't have any control over. And so the hardest lesson of my life and the most useful. And maybe there's something in that book that has that same combination of horror and revelation.
So just recognizing the position you're in and how hard it is to fight against that, to steer your zombie off course just a little bit, makes enough of a difference that you're not wallowing and thinking, my God, I'm surrounded by zombies, so I just can't.
Yeah. If you were a puppet, the worst and best thing that would ever happen to you is seeing the strings for the first time. And it would be horrifying at first, but then things would start to make more sense. And then you can maybe try to learn how to take more control of those strings. And I think assuming you don't have them is confusing and difficult. Like, that's why falling back into bad habits is so painful for people. I've read accounts of people who struggle with their weight, who find themselves binging, eating food, and hating themselves at the same time, crying while they're eating ice cream. And that conflict of not knowing where these struggles come from and why they exist and what we can do is more tragic than the actual struggle itself. You know, it's the it's that internal damaging spiral of monologue that really hurts people more than the actual bad behavior they started with, I think.
Something I wondered about this week, because I've been doing a kind of a Hugh Howey mixtape. It's been a week of revving up, knowing I was going to chat with you. So I've got all my Hugh Howey audiobooks, and I've been listening to a bit of each one. I've been listening to iZombie. And as we go through it, there are characters who did terrible things prior to the zombie apocalypse. They're all doing, of course, terrible things once they're zombies. And characters that did, you know, noble things. And it doesn't feel like the author gives the noble characters a break or overly punishes the characters that maybe kind of could have it coming. Is that intentional, or am I just reading that into it?
No, that's deliberate. And I'm flattered that you pick up on that. But I think that's life and reality. I remember my mom, her mantra growing up is that life wasn't fair. You know, be like, well, my sister got to do that, or my brother got to do that, or why? And she would say, like, you keep expecting life to be fair, and that's why you're confused and whining all the time. Life is not going to always be fair. And bad things happen to good people, and good things happen to bad people. And it doesn't mean we should accept it, but it also means that we should, we shouldn't accept it, but we should probably expect it. And so that was definitely something I wrestled with the book, that we all end up in the same place. We all end up trapped. A lot of people who are good can't help but be good. That's who they are. That's how they were born. It's the environment they grew up in, and all the experiences and influences they had in their life led to them being a good person. And giving them credit for it is okay in some ways, but it's also giving them more agency in what they've become than they probably deserve. It's the most challenging conversation you can have with anybody when you get in philosophy and bring this up among people who just want to have a good conversation, because as soon as someone hears they don't have free will, there's almost a violent response to that. The number one response I hear from people, like, we don't have free will, they're like, I can punch you in the face right now, like, and prove that I don't have it. I'm like, look, the fact that you want to punch me in the face right now is, like, you know, an automatic response to be challenged in the notion that you're in control of your fate. So, like, the fact that you feel like you need to hold back from punching me right now, you're living out, like, the natural cause and effect reaction to hearing this. But I was having a conversation with a friend in Australia a couple years ago about this. We're outside a cafe in Sydney, and we're talking about the lack of free will. And my buddy was on board with me, and his wife was not. And she's, like, one of the smartest people I know. She's really challenging my position. And I didn't know how to, you know, you're trying to figure out how to approach this question in a way that helps someone else wrestle with it, because I don't have all the answers, but I don't even often have the right questions. But I finally asked her, I'm like, could you choose to stop loving your husband right now? And she was like, you know, only if he did this, that, you know, if he did this or this. She gave me causes that would lead to the effect. And I was like, no, just sitting here right now, could you choose to stop loving him? And did you choose to start loving him, or did it just happen because of things that happened to you? And she realized, okay, I'm not free to stop loving him, and I wasn't free to prevent myself from falling in love with him. And I was like, you would rob him of the influence that he's had on your life. And if he said that he had free will, he would be robbing you of the influence you've had on his life, to say that I'm free to choose how I feel and what I do. When in reality is, this amazing person in my life has had this incredible influence and made me bond and feel things in a very powerful way. So in some ways, claiming free will is a kind of a slap in the face to the people around us that have, you know, that we love. The reason we love them is because we had no choice. They were who they were, and our response was to love them. And saying that I could give up that love anytime I wanted, just with a decision, is a fallacy. And I think when, you know, for her, that helped her see that, hey, there are certain things I'm not in control over. I like to think our will is like cats, like thinking that you have any control over what they do, you're out of your mind.
Now, Mabel's just a regular guest star on the show.
I love it. So sorry for the long-winded.
Viewers watch for her.
Yeah. I'd have been disappointed if she hadn't come in.